بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
A presentation of Quran Sunnah educational programs. Visit us online at www.qsep.com.
وَاتَّقُوا فِتْنَةً لَا تُصِيبَنَّ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْكُمْ خَاصَّةً.
Islamic principles for the Muslims' attitude during Fitan. Fourth principle: the Muslim must stick to the Jama'ah, the Imams and scholars of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, and abide by their sayings. Sheikh Saleh bin Abdulaziz Al-Sheikh writes, "This principle is based upon the saying of Allah, 'Hold fast, all of you together, to the rope of Allah, this Quran, and be not divided amongst yourselves.' And the saying of Allah's Messenger, 'Shaitan is the wolf that preys on mankind, as the real wolf preys on sheep, and snatches the sheep that wanders off alone. Beware of splitting, and stay with the Jama'ah, main body of Muslims.' It is established in the Hadith, which is narrated by Abdullah ibn Ahmad in Zawaid of Musnad Ahmad, that the Messenger of Allah said, 'Jama'ah is mercy, and division, differing, is agony, punishment.' All kinds of differing, whether in opinions, sayings, or actions, are a punishment with which Allah punishes those who oppose His command and follow other than the guidance. Therefore, he who adheres to the Jama'ah of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah and follows its Imams and scholars, he is the one who has adhered to the Jama'ah. He who separates from them has not secured himself from being amongst those who have divided and those who are punished by Allah in the worldly life. We ask Allah to protect us and all our brothers from all this."
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "He من فارق الجماعة شبرا فقد خلع ربقة الإسلام من عنقه." Allahu Akbar. He who separates himself from the Jama'ah as much as this much length, shibr, this is shibr, okay, then he has taken off Islam from his neck, or he has thrown Islam out. This is also, as we mentioned yesterday, doesn't mean that for any innovation one becomes a kafir. No. But this is to show how dangerous is this, to separate yourself and to act different from what you know that the scholars are acting or saying. You see, when scholars differ, you can weigh the truth from within what they say. You see, you cannot differ with all of them. And I am only speaking about real scholars. I'm not speaking about anyone who is called a scholar by stooges, you see, because if we do that, we have millions of scholars nowadays, okay? No. What do you expect from stooges? They call anyone a scholar, okay? Someone who can talk nicely, someone who can talk enthusiastically, someone who shouts, someone who cusses, someone who yani talks emotionally and all that. Scholar, oh, mashallah. He's a big scholar. You see? Scholars, according to the definition of Al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, are the ones who are declared as such by well-known scholars, not by other individuals, not by others, you see. So when scholars say that this person is a scholar and he is eligible to give a fatwa, then he is a scholar. Imam Malik rahimahullah said, I did not start giving any fatwa until more than 70 scholars said that you can give fatwa. Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah was a great scholar when he was 14 years old. Okay? And the scholars knew him. And he was not giving fatwa in that age. So they told him, why are you waiting? Go and give the fatwa. You are a scholar. Okay? So this is the way. It's the scholar is not decided by everyone. The scholar is decided by scholars. Okay? The well-known scholars say, yes, it's okay to learn from him. I remember Sheikh Al-Fawzan, a great scholar of nowadays, was asked about a man who says something in aqidah, issues of aqidah, which are fundamentals of Al-Sunnah. He says it today and he backs up tomorrow. And then he says something else tomorrow and he backs up after that. And then they mentioned several examples of those things that he said. He said, this person is a mushakkik. This person is a type of person which throws doubts in your hearts. You should not go and learn from him. You see? You should not go and learn from him. Yeah, he confuses you. Yani, today he says the Prophet ﷺ can make mistakes. This is one of his statements. Next day he says, no, astaghfirullah, I back up. He doesn't make mistakes. Next day he says something bad about some companions. Then he comes, oh, I'm sorry. No, I'm sorry. I didn't say that. You're sorry? Why are you rushing? Why are you doing this? And then these are fundamentals of Al-Sunnah. You cannot just be so ignorant in this and give fatwa to the people and assign yourself the biggest scholar in your area. Sheikh Al-Albani, rahimahullah, was asked by... This was in the 1980 when those followers of Juhayman, they entered Mecca and they made a big fitna, okay, which led to fighting in the haram itself and closing the haram for maybe 3 weeks. Okay, so Sheikh Al-Albani rahimahullah was asked, they said, but some of his followers were memorizing the whole 6 hadith books. You know, Sheikh Al-Albani answered as if, yani, this is nothing. Yani, he said, okay, so alhamdulillah, we have an extra copy of each hadith book in the library. Yani, so what? They memorize it, but they don't know the right meaning of those hadiths. You see, they are creating big fitnas in Muslim countries. Okay, so this is the point, that and those people, they were considering their leader to be a great scholar. Okay, nowadays we find people who consider ignorance to be great scholars, and they follow them. You know. And they not only follow them, but they take their judgments against our scholars. If they say about our scholars, they are hypocrites, they take it. They are kafirs, they take it. They are puppets of the governments, they take it. As granted, okay? So this shows that unfortunately, yani, in those fitnas, we have a big misconception about the jama'ah, The Jama'ah are the real scholars of Ahlul Sunnah who fear Allah, who when they answer you, you look in their answer and you see nothing but what Allah said and the Messenger said. And the right understanding of the verse and the right understanding of the hadith, okay? But while the innovators, even if they have some knowledge collected, they only choose the meaning of the verse which suits their innovation, and they only choose the hadith that suits their understanding, or at least they think it suits it. Otherwise, there is no true hadith which suits the wrong understanding. But that's what they think, yani. Okay. Yani, for example, Al-Qaradawi, you know about him. He is well-spoken in Al Jazeera and everywhere. He comes to the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, where the Prophet ﷺ says that the women are short in their deen and short in their memory and thinking, something like this. And the hadith is very clear. The Prophet explained it. He said, by short in their religion, I mean this. And by short in their memory or intellect, I mean this. Okay? He made it very clear, the Prophet ﷺ. And the scholars made it clearer. Alhamdulillah. He doesn't like this hadith. Although it's in Bukhari and other books, and it is sahih, he doesn't like it. And he says, no. The Prophet was only joking here. Joking? Subhanallah. The Prophet ﷺ would never joke with the truth. This is a slander against the Prophet ﷺ. You see. And sometimes he doesn't like the hadith and he cannot explain it in a way that suits his desire. So he says this hadith is weak even if it is in Sahih Muslim.
Sheikh Al-Albani speaks about Al-Qaradawi and his rejection of hadith in Sahih Al-Bukhari.
أياما أعرف الوقت السابق وكنت أنسقي مع القرضاوي والغزالي فما شعرت بهذا الفارق في السن لكن أشعر بأنهم تزامنا في الدراسة والمقصود ثم اتفقا في المنهج المنحرف عن السنة تجد الغزالي إذا ضعف حديثا صار وراءه القرضاوي وقد يكون العكس تماما التقيا في كثير من الأحاديث الصحيحة في تضييقها من أشهرها حديث البخاري الذي أصبح في هذا الزمن وسيلة لمعرفة المنحرفين عن السنة لأن هذا الحديث يعالج آفة قائمة في العصر الحاضر والناس ينجرفون بأهوائهم وراءها ومن كان من أعني بذاك الحديث حديث البخاري لا يكونن في أمتي أقوام يستحلون الحرى والحريرة والخمرة والمعازف يمسون في لهو ولعب ويصبحون وقد مسخوا قردة وخناجر الغزالي ضرب به عرض الحائط القرضاوي فعل فعله لكن مع التعبير السوري طبش عليه يعني زاد عليه فنقل كلمة ابن حزم الظاهري في حديث البخاري أنه حديث موضوع وهذا لا يقوله إنسان يعرف ما يخرج من فمه من عقله لأن الحديث موضوع كما يخفى على أخوانه كما لا يخفى على أخواننا جميعا هو ما رواه كذاب وضاع وهل في صحيح البخاري كذاب وضاع حاشاه مع ذلك هذا الحديث جاء من طرق غير طريق البخاري التي يتمسك بالغمز من صحة الإسناد في طريق البخاري فيأتي القرضاوي وهو يعلم رواية البخاري لهذا الحديث ويعلم تتابع علماء الحديث في الرد على ابن حزم فيضرب بهذه الجهود العلمية كلها عرض الحائط ويقول قال ابن حزم إنه حديث موضوع هذا يدل أنه يريد أن يساير العصر، يعني أن يأقلم الإسلام حسب إيش أهواء المعارضين في هذا الزمان. فمن هذا الشيء
Fifth principle. A Muslim must weigh the banners that are raised during Fitan in the scale of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah.
This is very important because nowadays the people do not distinguish someone who comes. Who is a Christian and who is a Jew, and he might be an atheist, might say something appealing to them, and they say, oh, mashallah, that's the truth, that's good. Regardless of his background and his religion and his way and all this, we are not saying that if some Christian says something which is true, you reject it because he's Christian. No. We are saying, don't rush into accepting something from anyone. You have to make sure of it. The fact that it is just appealing to you, this is not enough. You as a Muslim, whatever you take on as an opinion, this is going to be your religion that you will meet Allah with. فَانْظُرُوا عَمَّنْ تَأْخُذُوا دِينَكُمْ. That whatever you take on as an opinion, this is going to be a religion that you will be asked about on the Day of Judgment. So be careful who to take your religion from. You see? Yani if you believe this Christian or Jew or an innovator or whatever he might be, an ignorant Muslim, this is going to be your religion because you believe it. And this is your religion. You will be asked about it on the Day of Judgment. What is your source for this? Did Allah order you in his book? Did Allah say it in his book? Did the messenger order you? Did the messenger say this? So what's your answer in this? You don't have an answer. You cannot say, oh Allah, I heard it on TV. Oh Allah, I heard it from such and such satellite. Oh Allah, I heard it from such and such speaker, such and such. This is not enough. You see, this is not enough. Now, so this is very important. Yani one has to, nowadays, unfortunately, we find Muslims rushing to accept things from people like Bush and Obama and those people, and you know, people who are non-Muslims, they are kafirs. You don't accept anything from them until you are sure that what they said is in accordance to our religion. Otherwise, don't accept anything from anyone. Kafir, innovator, even an ignorant Muslim, don't accept. Now, how to weigh things? Yani for example, Islam. How to weigh what is Islam? Everyone is telling you, I have the Islam. Okay. Islam, my brothers, first means Tawheed. It means tawheed. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بَلَا مَنْ أَسْلَمَ وَجْهَهُ لِلَّهِ وَهُوَ مُحْسِنٌ. That indeed the one who submits his face to Allah, and that is by tawheed, by sincerity. وَهُوَ مُحْسِنٌ, while following the right way, the sharia of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, to weigh Islam, we weigh it by the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Messenger. If someone says, Islam is to be sufficient from anyone who says, I am a Muslim, la ilaha illallah. Even if he commits shirk, even if he goes around the graves and seeks blessings from the grave, even if he says the rule of Allah is not suitable for this age, or such and such sharia in this religion is not suitable for this age, even if he curses Allah, even he says, khalas, he's a Muslim because he says he's a Muslim. we tell him, this is not Islam. What you're saying is not Islam. Islam is to have tawheed and to obey Allah and His Messenger. Islam is submission to Allah and His Messenger. So this is very important. Yani nowadays, some people present Islam as jihad only. And they say, forget about da'wah, forget about this, forget about that. And they dare to call those who are involved in da'wah hypocrites. Hypocrites, they say. Why? Because they are not making jihad. Okay. So to them, there is nothing in Islam but jihad. Who says this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made jihad one of the branches of faith and one of the branches of Islam, and it is a great branch of Islam, it is a great branch of faith, but it's not the only. And when you cannot make jihad, you don't even have to make it. Okay? You shouldn't make it if it leads to chaos and evil for Muslims. It's not jihad.
When will we establish the Islamic State in our hearts? Explanation by Allama Al-Albani.
ما لازم نفكر الآن إنه إمتى بدي زمان نخرج اليهود من فلسطين. لا لازم نفكر نحن الآن متى نستطيع أن نقيم دولة إسلام في قلوبنا نحن؟ متى تستطيع أن تقيم دولة إسلام في دولتك الصغيرة في دارك؟ ومع الأسف أكثر الذين ينادون بإقامة حكم الإسلام على وجه الأرض هم لا يقيمون حكم الإسلام في دورهم في ذوات أنفسهم في أولادهم في بناتهم في نسائهم فأخذ الشيء لا يعطيه.
Some say no jihad is to establish Islam is to establish the Islamic state first. In the beginning we should not care about telling people this is shirk, this is tawheed, and this is this and this is that. Like Hassan al-Banna, the one who started Ikhwan al-Muslimun, this was his way. Someone asked him about tawassul, which in his time, it meant to supplicate to the awliya. They used to call supplication to the awliya tawassul. And he said, I'm not a scholar. I don't want to answer you. And he was very happy with this, that he avoided his question. How could you avoid his question when this is tawheed and shirk? When you see people going around the graves and seeking blessings from the graves and slaughtering animals to the engraved, all acts of shirk, and you come to them and give them a speech, you are good people, we only have the Jews as our enemies. So, my brothers, be pure-hearted towards each other. This is his khutbah near the grave. And it's recorded in his book, Khutab al-Thulatha. Not a single khutbah that he did in this book, even though he was doing a lot of his khutbahs near those graves. He used to go purposely there because there are a lot of people and he wants to gain them to his da'wah. Not a single khutbah. He said one word about shirk, and shirk is in front of his eye. And he says, this is our Islam. And our concern now is to bring back the Khilafah. And then after that, things will be easier to correct and all this. Okay. What kind of Khilafah is this? This is the opposite way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. And you are saying the opposite. You are saying, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ أَنْشَأُوا الْخِلَافَةِ ثُمَّ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. How could you do this? You should go by what Allah said. Allah says, have right faith first. Act righteously upon this faith. Allah will grant you khilafah. This is a promise from Allah. إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرْكُمْ. You see? And you are coming to the people who are committing great shirk, and you are, as if you are telling them, remain as you are, but just be pure-hearted towards each other, don't hate each other, and all this. Nice things, which will they say, Jazakallah khair, Sheikh Hassan, Jazakallah khair. Okay? But he knows that if he tells them, what you're doing is shirk, and if you die on this, you will go to hellfire, they will spit on him, maybe. So he doesn't want to say that. So why do you go there if you cannot say anything? You are approving them. And he writes in his memories, I used to go every Jum'ah to one of those sites, which is called sites, sites of Zainab, site of Sinjar, site of Kissinger, maybe, Allahu A'lam. Okay? And he used to go there and just tell them nice things that they like to hear so that he gains them. That's why his followers became more than 2 million. You can easily gather people. But this is what? This is not a sign of success. The Prophet ﷺ said, prophets will come on the Day of Judgment with only handful of followers. And some prophet will come with no followers at all. Was he successful or not? In the eyes of Allah, he was successful. But in the eyes of stooges like those, he was not successful. Oh, what did he do? No one followed him. So this is bad. Oh, no, this is not the way. The guidance is up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not up to you. Your duty is to follow Quran and Sunnah. To follow the truth, you see. So how do we know that this banner is Islam or not? Is it Islam? Is it kufr? And if it is Islam, is it sunnah? Is it innovation? We weigh first Islam from not Islam. We weigh it by tawheed. And we weigh sunnah from bid'ah by the aqidah, by the fundamentals of aqidah, faith. You see, Ahl Sunnah have made it clear in their Aqid books what are the fundamentals which make someone from Ahl Sunnah. For example, what has been written by Imam al-Tahawi, the Hanafi scholar, the Aqidah of Ahl Sunnah, and many other books which include all those fundamentals of Ahl Sunnah. So, for you to weigh, you have to know those fundamentals. You have to know those fundamentals, you see. And if you don't know them, how could you weigh? How could you say he's an innovator or not? The takfiris, they have their own fundamentals. If you declare those who they declare to be kafirs, you declare them kafirs, then you are a Muslim and you are Sunni. If you don't, then you are a kafir. You are a kafir because you don't have wala and bara, allegiance and disallegiance. You see? If you say one ruler is a Muslim, you are a kafir. You are a kafir. Okay? One ruler, you say he is a Muslim, you are a kafir. You have to agree with them that all rulers are kafirs. Why? Because their heads say that. You see? So this became the fundamental for them. So the fundamentals are there. First of all, Islam and not Islam from Tawheed. If someone propagates any form of great shirk, then this is not an Islamic banner. It's not enough to see him talk smoothly and nicely and smile and this and that, you know. And then he says, there is nothing wrong with supplicating to the awliya. You know, you cannot say, mashallah, he's speaking nicely and softly and this. So he's he's right, or he's saying good things. No. So we judge by tawheed and by the fundamentals of Aqidah that are agreed upon by all Ahlul Sunnah and written in their books, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It's written and the proofs are there. That's why we have to study them. not only study them, but study their proofs and know them. Because in aqeedah, it's not sufficient to know the thing, it's an obligation to know the proofs. Because surety is required. And surety needs what? Proofs. In matters of fiqh, we can be lenient. We can say, okay, if you know what to do in salat, we can be lenient with you if you don't know the proofs. Okay? But in aqeedah, you have to know the proofs. In fundamentals of al-sunnah, you have to know the proofs. And no one can shake you if you know the truth. Okay? No one can shake you. Because you know what Allah says and what the Messenger says. And what ulama al-sunnah, the scholars of al-sunnah has agreed upon, and they made it fundamentals in their aqeedah book. It's fundamental because it's agreed upon. You see? No one can shake you. You see? But if you don't know them, everyone can shake you. He'll bring a lot of gossip and fill it with emotions and this and that. And all of a sudden you find himself, you are with him. Oh, okay, you are right, you are right. You don't know how he put the wrong thing in your mind. Okay? Nah.
Sheikh Salih bin Abdulaziz Al-Sheikh writes while explaining the fifth principle. The ruling of the existence of Islam from its non-existence, the ruling of Iman or Kufr, should be referred to the scholars of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, and not to others from amongst the students who perhaps know some part and are ignorant of the other, or perhaps they generalize something which should not be generalized. So, the judge in these issues, for those who cannot weigh the issues with the correct scales, are the scholars from the people of knowledge. It is obligatory that we take their sayings and conclusions concerning evaluation of Iman and Kufr and other issues we have mentioned above. It is the scholars who decide whether a particular ruler has left Islam. Explanation by Sheikh Salih bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan.
يا أخوان الأمور من فوضى راجعوا العلماء في هذا راجعوا العلماء في هذا هم الذين يقررون أن هذا ولي الأمر خرج من الإسلام فلا تجوز طاعته أو أنه لم يخرج ولا تجوز مخالفته هذا راجع إلى أهل العلم اسألوه.
First of all, what is kufr is decided by the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, just like what is halal and what is haram. Kufr is the greatest haram, you see. So it cannot be decided by me and you. If you say this is kufr, this is shirk, this is nifaq, first of all, you have to know the meaning of kufr, shirk, and nifaq. And you have to know the proofs from Quran and Sunnah. And then in this particular action, to consider it kufr, you have to bring also a proof that this is kufr. Okay? So it's not something that we make up by opinion. No. It's a ruling of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever Allah has ruled to be kufr, whatever the Messenger has ruled to be kufr, whatever Allah has ruled to be shirk, whatever the Messenger has ruled to be shirk, whatever Allah has ruled to be hypocrisy, whatever the Messenger has ruled to be hypocrisy, and so on. Innovation is the same, okay? So, this is one thing. The other thing, if you are sure that this action is kufr, sometimes you cannot declare the person a kafir. Because if you do, the outcome will be evil for others. Not for you, but for others. Let's say we have a big tyrant, ruler, and you come and declare him kafir. And to protect himself, because you have a beard and you have a certain look, he goes and brings all people, all youth like you, take them all to prison, okay? Or do something harmful to them, or do some other harmful to the Muslims because of this. So it's not up to you. It's only up to the scholars of Ahl-Sunnah. Also, when we have hidden issues, like, for example, nowadays in Muslim countries, to grow a long beard, it's a hidden issue. A lot of people don't know that it is from Sunnah, okay? So if someone comes and says, what is this dirt? He is pointing to the long beard or something. You don't declare him kafir here. This person need to be taught first, because this issue has become hidden for most of the people. So most of the people like him do not know the ruling of a long beard. Okay? The cover of the face for the woman. Most of the people nowadays don't know that this is an obligation. So if someone comes and denies it outright, you don't declare a kafir. You see? And hidden issues, we go to scholars and tell them, there is a person who says this, 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 and he will say, yani, okay. It's not up to us. It's not up to us. But clear issues, you can declare him a kafir or a mushrik, as long as this does not involve harm to other Muslims. You see? This is all regarding non-clear issues, non-apparent issues, okay? Or the issues in which there should be some kind of detail, like ruling with other than the rule of Allah, like seeking allegiance with the kafirs. There are two types of kufr in those actions. Ruling with other than the rule of Allah, there is great kufr and there is small kufr, okay? Seeking allegiance with the kafir, there are three levels: great kufr, great shirk, small shirk, and haram. Okay? The least thing is haram. Okay? So, in those issues, one should not haste based on the verse, وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّهُ مِنْكُمْ فَإِنَّهُ مِنْهُمْ. He who seeks allegiance with them, then he is one of them. Or verses like that. You see? Because he only knows this verse and he doesn't know the other verses. The verse which says, which Allah revealed for the case of Hatib, the companion, the Badri. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, la tattakhidhu aduwi wa aduwakum awliya. Allah called him mu'min. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu. Even though he sought allegiance with the kafirs, one of the worst kinds, he sent them news of the army of the Prophet ﷺ, warning them that the Prophet has this, 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 this. But his excuse was that he was sure in his heart that Allah will reveal the secret to the Prophet ﷺ. And he did it because he wanted to have some favor for the mushriks so that they don't harm his family in Mecca, because they are weak and they have no one to support them. So the Prophet ﷺ did not declare him a kafir, even though his action is spying and his action is very big, yani, you see. And Allah called it allegiance to the kafirs. But Allah did not declare him a kafir, and the Prophet did not declare him a kafir. And he himself said, I didn't do this out of kufr, yani due to kufr, you see. Yeah, but being a people of Badr does not forgive kufr, great kufr. He has to repent from that. Yani, Allah forgiven the people of Badr from the sins that they do, not from the kufr and shirk, you see. Generalizing now is very easy. Yani, all rulers are kafirs. All scholars who work with the rulers, they are hypocrites, kafirs. All countries now, I heard someone say on Al Jazeera, they are all Darul Kufr. On Paltok, I'm sorry, not on Al Jazeera. All of them are Darul Kufr. They said, how about Mecca, Sheikh? And he said, Mecca, I'm not sure. he's not sure that Mecca is Darul Islam, a place of Islam. MashaAllah, very pious. Not sure, I'm not sure. Very pious, MashaAllah. And every other country is there. And he's a big sheikh for the takfiris. Oh, you should see how they present him when he comes.
Sixth principle. There are rules for statements and actions during fitan. Not every saying which appears good to you should be expressed. And not every action which appears good to you should be carried out. Because during times of fitan, your statements and actions will have consequences. Sheikh Saleh bin Abdulaziz Al-Sheikh writes, while explaining the sixth principle, people do not correctly understand all the talk of the speaker concerning every issue of fitan. They might hear something which their minds do not comprehend, and then base upon it their beliefs, attitudes, actions or statements which will not lead to good consequences. Therefore, the Salaf, our predecessors, were considerably acting upon this.
Like Imam Malik rahimahullah said a very important wisdom. He said, ما كل ما يعلم يقال ولا كل ما يقال حضر أوانه ولا كل ما حضر أوانه حضر رجاله. Not everything which is known to be said, and not everything which is to be said is to always be said, and not everything which is to be said is to be said in front of everyone. You see, and this is also according to what Umar radiallahu anh was about to do in Hajj time. He was about to announce something to all the Hujjaj. Then Abdullah ibn Abbas came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, came to Umar radiallahu anh, and he said, oh Amir al-Mu'mineen, why don't you wait until we go back to Medina? And you will be alone with the companions who are knowledgeable and who were with the Prophet ﷺ, and say what you want there. Because those people who come from everywhere, you know, they might not understand what you said in the right way. And Umar agreed. You see. And that's also from the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ where he said, لا تبشرهم فيتكلوا. When the Prophet said to Abu Huraira رضي الله عنه, give those whom you meet this glad tiding, that anyone who says لا إله إلا الله will enter paradise. So Abu Huraira wanted to make sure, or the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, those who say لا إله إلا الله will enter paradise. So Abu Huraira said, should I give this glad tidings to the people? The Prophet said, no. If you do, they will misunderstand it. They will think that it's just the word without action, without understanding. He said, if you say it to everyone who might understand it that way, they will depend on uttering the word only. You see, and this is false, you see. That's why Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, when he brought this hadith, he said, Bab Jawaz Kitman Ba'adhu al-ilm. That sometimes it is necessary to hide some knowledge from the people. You see, because if you mention it, they will misuse it. They will misunderstand it, and they will misuse it. Al-Hajjaj was a big tyrant. Yani, as narrations say, he killed about 100,000, yani, most of them were students of the companions, and some of them were companions also. Al-Hajjaj killed them. He was a very tyrant man. And one companion told him a hadith about an incident that happened in the Prophet's time, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered that a certain group who killed Muslims and who took their eyes out and did a lot of bad things to some Muslims, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered that the same thing be done to them as a punishment. So another companion saw this man narrating the hadith to Hajjaj. The man said, "Are you crazy? Why are you narrating this to Hajjaj? Because this is going to be his excuse for more actions of punishment for the Muslims and killing. He will take this as an excuse." Okay. So these are the things that discuss. Nowadays, alhamdulillah, for example, when Saddam conquered Kuwait, the scholars that we know, scholars of Saudi Arabia and most of the scholars, they said it is okay to seek support from others, even if they were non-Muslims, to kick out Saddam. Okay. And some da'is, good da'is, not bad da'is, good da'is, they thought that this is very bad and that the scholars' knowledge of the situation is short. Okay. And they started speaking out against the scholars. And they thought that the Americans are going to come here and never leave, or something like this. Okay. And that this is going to be a very bad thing. And the scholars, have no knowledge of the situation at all. And the opposite was the result, alhamdulillah. Country was saved from Saddam. And the Americans left, and everyone left, and everything is back to normal. Okay.
Demonstrations are a cause of fitna. Explanation by Sheikh Abdulaziz Ibn Baz.
المظاهرات والاعتصامات هل هي من
لا هذا غلط هذا غلط هذا غلط هذا غلط فتنه هذا شر ما يصلح
جزاكم الله خيرا يقول السائل هل المظاهرات الرجاليه والنسائيه ضد الحكام والولاة تعتبر وسيله من وسائل الدعوه وهل من يموت فيها يعتبر شهيدا او في سبيل الله
لا ارى المظاهرات النسائيه والرجاليه من العلاج ولكن ارانا من اسباب الفتن ومن اسباب الشرور ومن اسباب ظلم بعض الناس والتعدي على بعض الناس بغير حق ولكن الاسباب الشرعيه المكاتبه والنصيحه والدعوه الى الخير بالطرق السليمه الطرق ساكها العلم ساكها اصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم واتباعهم باحسان بالمكاتبه والمشافهه مع المختلف ومع الامير ومع السلطان اتصال به ونصحته ومكاتبه له دون التشييع في منابر وغيره بانك على كذا وصار منه كذا اللهم
In many of the situations that occur nowadays, for example, those so-called demonstrations which happened in Tunis, in Egypt, the scholars said it is, the demonstrations are not actions of Islam, are not means of correction. They are actions that we have brought from kafirs, okay? And then they mentioned a lot of things, a lot of evil which occurs in those demonstrations. Mixing of women with men, women shouting and saying what they want and doing what they want, sometimes dancing like what happened in Egypt and everything. Okay. And also, not only that, everyone comes and uses this demonstration for his own purpose. A Christian Egyptian will come and raise the cross, as happened. Okay, and the they can shout slogans, or a stupid Muslim will say, "We Egyptians are all brothers, Muslims and Christians, and all this." This destroys, concepts which are fundamental in Islam. You cannot say this, okay. And what is the result? that they removed Mubarak and someone else sat in front, you know, instead of him. So what happened, Yani? Until now, nothing happened. Nothing good. And Allah knows, maybe the one that will come finally and will have the power finally and settle down might be much worse than Mubarak. Even if he is just in matters of life, he might be corrupt in his thoughts. And he wants to westernize everything. This is the biggest corruption. For a Muslim to remain as a Muslim, even if he is poor, this is much better than living rich and wealthy, but with a westernized thoughts, kufr thoughts. Okay. So you have not done any good. Islamically, you have not done any good by this. And the scholars say this. They say, no, don't do those demonstrations in Muslim countries. Okay. When this happened in Libya, the situation was different because Muammar al-Qaddafi was declared to be a non-Muslim a lot of years ago because he denied Sunnah altogether. He mocked Sunnah and he denied it and he said Sunnah is a satanic innovation. He actually hinted, as I saw it by myself in the 80s on American TV, an interview with Barbara Walters, the Jewish woman. He hinted that he is a prophet. She told him, we know from history that all prophets raised cattle and they were shepherds. And we see you interested in raising cattle and being a shepherd or something like this. Do you consider yourself a prophet? He said, yes. He dropped words of Quran. To drop one letter from Quran, as Ali radiallahu anhu said, to deny one letter of Quran, this is great kufr. Okay, how could you drop qul? Qul huwa Allah ahad. He says, no, don't say qul. That's only for the prophet. You just say Allahu ahad, Allahu samad, ya ayyuhal kafirun. You don't say qul ya ayyuhal kafirun. Anyway, in his case, the scholars like Sheikh Saleh Al-Luhaydan, the chief judge in Saudi Arabia, the head before, he said, get rid of him with as less bloodshed as possible. If it takes you 2 hours to get rid of him in a bloody way and you kill a lot of Muslims, then think of a substitute which will not take that route of bloodshed, you know. That's what he said, and many other scholars said. No.
Disobedience of the people to Allah reflects in their rulers. Explanation by Sheikh Muhammad ibn Saleh ibn al-Uthaymeen.
وهذه نقطة يجب أن نتفطن به لها. معصية الناس لولاة الأمور بقدر معصية ولاة الأمور لله عز وجل. فكلما أطاع ولاة الأمور ربهم أخضع الله لهم قلوب الناس وأطاعوهم ولم يتمردوا عليهم. فمن اتقى الله في من ولاه الله عليه اتقاه من ولاهم الله عليه. والعكس بالعكس. ويذكر أن عبد الملك بن مروان لما رأى تمرد الناس عليه جمع أشراف الناس وخطبهم وقال لهم إنكم تريدون منا أن نكون لكم كأبي بكر وعمر فأنتم كونوا لنا كرجال أبي بكر وعمر فنكون لكم كأبي بكر وعمر. وجاء رجل من الخوارج إلى علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه فقال له يا علي ما بال الناس خرجوا عليك ولم يخرجوا على أبي بكر وعمر؟ فقال له لأن رجالي أنت وأمثالك ورجال أبي بكر أنا وأمثالي. فألقمه حجرا.
As a matter of fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it clearly in his book. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, القرآن وكذلك نولي بعض الظالمين بعضا بما كانوا يكسبون. That this is our way, Allah is saying, this is our sunnah, is to install tyrants, unjust rulers, above unjust people who have done injustice to themselves by doing sins. You see? That's why there's a statement in Arabic which says, كَمَا تَكُونُوا يُوَلَّ عَلَيْكُمْ. يعني you will get the ruler of your type. If you are bad, you will get a bad ruler. If you are unjust, you will get an unjust ruler. So what is the situation? How to get rid of him? We should change ourselves by repenting to Allah and by going in the right path. And then Allah promised, he said, إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرْكُمْ. If you give victory to Allah, how do we give victory to Allah? By obeying him, by acting upon his orders. We cannot give victory to Allah. This is the way. There is no other way to give victory to Allah but to be obedient servants of Allah, to repent from all the wrong things we have, and to know our religion and to act upon our what we know. Right now, I assure you that more than 99% of Muslims don't even know the meaning of khushu', let alone acting upon it. 99% maybe don't even know the meaning of khushu', you see. And khushu' is the criterion for accepting your prayer and rewarding you for. And it is the criterion for your prayers, whether it's going to be advantageous for you or not. إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. Salat is supposedly to forbid you from evil. Is your salat forbidding you from evil? No. People leave their shops after they have been lying to customers, cheating and all that. They go in the masjid, they come back, they cheat the same way and more. Nothing changed. You see. So this is a big thing. We have to change ourselves. And we have to be patient and acting upon the orders of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَيُمَكِّنَنَّ لَهُمْ دِينَهُمْ الَّذِي ارْتَضَى. This is a promise from Allah. وَعَدَ اللَّهُ. Allah does not break his promise. But two things. Iman, the right faith, which we have to learn, and then acting upon the right faith in the right way. وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Allah will provide us with rulership, with khilafah, with good things. You see. So we cannot suffer about 50 people who are rulers here and there and ignore Allah a'lam how many millions of Muslims, or billions of Muslims now, okay? And we say, no, first we have to change the rulers. This is unjust. You cannot do this. No. They are a punishment from Allah for us because of our sins. So we have to change ourselves. We have to repent to Allah. We have to show Allah our deep regret of what we are. No.
Seventh principle. Allah has ordered us to align ourselves with the believers, especially the scholars. Sheikh Salim bin Abdulaziz Al-Sheikh writes, while explaining the seventh principle, the believing men and the believing women, as Allah says, are allies of each other. It is obligatory upon every believer to love the believers, support them, and refrain from mocking them. So how about if these believers were the supporters of the religion of Allah, and they were the ones who explained to the people the halal and the haram, and they are the ones who make falsehood apparent to the people? It is prohibited to mention the scholars except with respect. Those gatherings in which the scholars are not mentioned with respect are evil gatherings. Why? Because the scholars are the inheritors of the prophets. The prophets do not leave behind dinar or dirham. Rather, they leave behind knowledge. So he who takes from it, then he has taken great good. So he who respects the scholars and takes the statements of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the people of Tawheed, then he has achieved inheritance of the prophets.
This is very important. Yani, the Shaykh is saying it is haram to mention the scholars with other than that which is good and praise for them. Okay? This is very important. Why? It's not because of the persons of those scholars. It's because the scholars are the carriers of this religion. And they are the jama'ah. They are our way to understand the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This doesn't mean if a scholar makes a mistake that it is haram to say politely that this is a mistake and bring your proof. It's okay to do this. It's okay. This because you are not mentioning them with evil. You say, he is a great scholar, mashallah, may Allah reward him, but this is a mistake. And the proof is this. You bring verses and hadith and saying of other scholars. And make sure you bring sayings of other worthy scholars. Don't just depend on your understanding of Quran and Sunnah. No, make sure that when this scholar made this mistake, other scholars have shown that otherwise, that it's not like what he's saying, okay? So criticizing a scholar politely, this is good. This is not what the Sheikh meant here. But what is meant is what those takfiris do nowadays. When a scholar says something that they think it's important and good and in their favor, all of a sudden he becomes a big scholar to them, allama and good and mashallah. And then when he says something they dislike in a certain issue which they think it's very important, they shout at him, oh, what does he know? He's a kafir, he's a hypocrite. He's a puppet of the governments. He is this, he is that.
Slandering the scholars pleases the disbelievers. Explanation by Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan al-Fawzan.
وهذا عدو ثالث وهو الذي يظهر الدين والغيرة هم يسب العلماء من دافع الغيرة وأنهم قصروا وأنهم ما قاموا بالواجب. طيب أنت وش قمت فيه؟ ماذا أديت؟ إلا الوقيعة في أهل العلم. هذا يفرح الكفار أيضا. هذا والله يفرح الكفار إذا أسقط العلماء أمام الناس وأسقطت هيبتهم ومكانتهم فإنهم لا يسمع منهم بعد ذلك. وهذا يفرح الكفار. فهذا عدو ثالث احذروا منه. ناصحوا من تقدرون على مناصحته أن يكف لسانه وأن لا يساعد الأعداء في الطعن في علماء المسلمين. لا يساعدهم على ذلك ويسقط مكانة العلماء في المجتمع. نعم.
Those are devils because they are blocking the people from truth, because scholars have the truth, okay? And to distort the scholars, you are blocking the people from the truth. You see? If people think bad about the scholars, then who would they refer to? Who? You see? It's either the devils or the innovators or those ignorance, heads of ignorance. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in the true hadith, that amongst the sign of the Day of Judgment, that the Ruwaybida will speak out, because all the scholars are gone. Okay? And the Ruwaybida is a person who is either an innovator, according to one explanation, or it's someone who is so ignorant. Yani. He speaks in very important issues, you know. Oh, all the Egyptians should go out into demonstration. You know, it's an obligation. It is haram not to go into this. You see? So those are the Ruwaybida, people like them, yani, or the innovators. Now,
be cautious, fearful, and alert from non-scholars. Explanation by Sheikh Salim bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan.
وأهل العلم معروفون. ما كل من معه شهادة تخرج من كلية أو ما كل من حفظ حديث أو حفظ آيات. ما كل من قرأ الكتب يكون فقيها. فقهاء معروفون عند الناس. ولكن بعض الناس أو كثير من الناس إنما يريد اللي يصلح له فقط. يدور اللي يصلح له. لو هو قال لو اللي قايله من أجهل الناس أو من أضل الناس حتى. المهم إنه يافق هواه ورغبته. هذا خطر عظيم. ولا سيما في هذا الوقت إنه قل العلماء قل الفقهاء وكثر القراء كثر القراء وقل الفقهاء وفي قوله صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله لا يقبض إن الله إن الله لا يقبض هذا العلم لا يقبض هذا العلم انتزاعا من صدور الرجال وإنما يقبض العلم بموت الأبهام وإنما يقبض العلم بموت العلماء حتى إذا لم يبقى عالم اتخذ الناس رؤوسا جهالا فأفتوا بغير علم فضلوا وأضلوا ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله نخشى أن يكون بدأ هذا في وقتنا فعلينا أن نأخذ الحذر والخوف والاحتياط وأن نختار أهل العلم وأهل الثقة حسب الإمكان حسب الإمكان وحسب الموجودين أما العلماء السابقون والأحبار هؤلاء ذهبوا لكن خير الموجودين خير الموجودين اتقوا الله ما استطعتم نسأل الله أن يوفقنا وإياكم لمعرفة الحق والعمل به صلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه
Eighth principle, disassociation from the disbelievers is an important principle. It should always be on one's mind. Sheikh Salim bin Abdul Aziz Al Sheikh writes while explaining the eighth principle. Disassociation from the disbelievers is an important principle and it should always be on one's mind. There are two words with different meanings in the Sharia and with the Imams of Tawheed. Many people confuse between these two words, Tawalli and Muwalat. Tawalli is disbelief. Muwalat is forbidden, impermissible. Seeking assistance from the disbelievers. This is permissible with conditions. So these are three issues.
Differentiating between tawalli and muwalat is something which maybe Sheikh Saleh has done because some of the scholars of Najd have done it before him. And it's okay as long as the meaning is right, you see. But actually, tawalli and muwalat are one thing. Okay, they are one thing. And when we say that muwalat and tawalli is one thing, we divide it into three categories. When you help the kafirs against the Muslims wanting to wipe out Islam. Okay? This is great kufr. It takes someone out of Islam. Okay? That's why when Samah Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah was asked about those who propagate the thoughts of the communists amongst Muslims. They help the communists to propagate their thoughts and things like that. He said, seeking allegiance with the kafirs is great kufr, and it nullifies Islam based on this question. Okay? And you know, you can see clearly what kind of allegiance the Sheikh is talking about. When you are deliberately supporting the kafirs to spread kufr, you see, then you have committed great kufr by this action. Similarly, when you help the kafirs to kill Muslims, to weaken Islam, to wipe out Islam, okay, thinking that without Islam we'll be better off, we'll open the gates for progress and all this. And we have a lot of people who do this. Okay? So this is great kufr. But like what Hatib has done, the great companion here, he helped the mushriks not to wipe out Islam. And above that, he was sure in his heart that Allah will reveal what he has done to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay? And despite that, Allah blamed him, and he said, you should not have sought allegiance with my enemies. Allah called it seeking allegiance, but he did not declare him kafir because he said, ya ayyuha alladhina amanu. And this is not kafir. Yani, oh you who are faithful, do not seek allegiance with my enemies and your enemies. So this is a clear verse which shows that seeking allegiance, even in some of its worst forms, like spying, is not necessarily great kufr. And Imam Shafi'i, rahimahullah, based on this verse and the incident of Hatib, he said, I say that spying is not great kufr. And then he brought this incident. Okay? And many other scholars are like him in this. So, يعني, the issue of tawalli or muwalat, it's not like black and white, either great kufr or يعني, no crime at all. No, it has levels, it has degrees. This is one thing. Another thing, what is muwalat? Is dealing with the kafirs muwalat? Not always. You can deal with them. The Prophet ﷺ used to buy and sell from them. The Prophet ﷺ used to borrow weapons from them sometimes, from the Jews. The Prophet ﷺ used to go and visit them sometimes for the sake of da'wah. You see, some companions used to smile in their faces sometimes. Like Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said, there are people who we smile at their faces and our hearts are cursing them. Okay? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once received a hypocrite in his home with smiles and, you know, respect and calm. And then when he left, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Bi'sa akhul ashira." What an evil person this is, or something like this. So Aisha radiallahu anha said, when he came in, you received him in a way, in a nice way, gentle way, and all that. And when he left, you are saying this? He said, yes, Aisha. شَرُّ النَّاسِ مَنْ أَحْسَنَ النَّاسُ إِلَيْهِ اتِّقَاءَ شَرِّهِ. The most evil of the people are those who you have to, you are obligated to be nice to them to avoid their evil. To get rid of their evil, you see. That's why in zakat, there is one of the eight categories which you can give kafirs money to avoid their evil, to avoid their evil, to stop them from killing the Muslims if they are stronger, you know. Give them money. The government give them money. Here, take this 10 million and don't attack the Muslims. Because we are not strong enough to stand in your face. And because we need to save the lives of our Muslim brothers. Here, take 10 million. Yalla. Take 100 million. Take this. No, they don't understand the least. The least they don't understand. They don't understand who are the scholars. They don't understand all the pillars of jihad and conditions of jihad and obligations of jihad. Yani Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, as I mentioned earlier, said any fighting in which you're not sure about the outcome, whether it's going to be the good for Muslims or evil, worst, yani, this is qitalu fitna, he said. It is haram to get involved in it. Nowadays, they go into actions of fighting and all that, and all the intellectuals and the scholars tell them, we are sure that the outcome is going to be worse. Please don't do it. And yet they say, spit on you. You are all puppets. We go and do it anyway. And then they bring more evil in this country, and then they go to the other country, and they bring more evil. They don't care. Allah ordered us with fighting. Khalas. One of the Hanafi scholars, Tabari, not the Tabari, the Mufassir, he quoted the consensus of Muslim scholars that if the enemies of Allah conquer Muslims in their country, and the scholars and those who have the thinking in that country decide that if they fight back, the outcome is going to be much worse, then it is haram to fight back. Because Islam is the religion of wisdom. Islam is the religion of good. Islam is the religion of bringing what is good for the Muslims. And they say, no, this is cowardness. This is hypocrisy. This is this. And this is the consensus of all Muslim scholars. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, when he said this about Qital al-Fitna, he was not a coward. He led the armies in his time against the Tatars. Because he was sure that, alhamdulillah, the Muslims, at least they don't have shirk. Okay, they got rid of the shirk. And they also, a lot of them had the right aqidah. And the king was a pious man. Even though he was Ash'ari, not from the Salaf. But he was a pious man, and he was a good man. So he came to him and he said, I encourage you to fight them. Allah will give us victory. They said, say inshallah, Ibn Taymiyyah. Say inshallah. He said, if you have to hear it, I say inshallah, tahqiqan, la ta'liqan. Yani, I don't say inshallah in a way that maybe it will happen or not. No, I say inshallah while I am sure it will happen. The victory will happen. Because Allah says, in tansurullah yansurkum. If you give victory to Allah, Allah guarantees your victory. You see? So when the Tatars heard this, they didn't even show up. And the Muslims, alhamdulillah, were relieved. You see, they didn't have to go because the Tatars didn't show up. Even though the Tatars were so strong and they were yani, doing their actions in a way that they were, yani, a woman from them would tell 10 men, wait here, I'll go and bring a knife to kill you all, and they will wait. Because there is no tawheed in their heart. No faith in their heart. How could you expect victory? You see? You have to have tawheed. You have to have the right faith. You have to act upon the faith. You have to repent to Allah. And then expect victory. But you want Muslims like this nowadays? Oh, come jihad, 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 jihad. سبحان الله. نعم. As Sheikh Muhammad Aman rahimahullah once said, this is like building a beautiful fancy mosque and putting nice rugs and everything, and then sending someone to the market and telling the people, come to the mosque, come together. If you are a male or female, properly dressed or improperly dressed, you have wudu, you don't have wudu, you are on janaba, you are not on janaba, you are a Muslim, you are a kafir, you are Sunni, you are innovator. Just come, come, come to the masjid, come, let's pray together. He says, this is not the logic of Islam. This is not the logic of Islam, you see. Now that's what they are doing, you know. You saw the demonstrations in Egypt. One is raising the cross, and the other one has a small Quran, raising it besides it. And the cross is that big. A woman was asked, a communist woman. She said, I'm communist, I'm proud of it. And then a woman which was covering her face, wearing niqab, coming and kissing her. Oh, we are all sisters. We have nothing different between us. Okay, we are all together. Stooge. She says, I'm a communist. Communists base their way on denying Allah altogether. Just because we are together demonstrating against Mubarak. Okay? SubhanAllah. How about the Mubarak that is in you? The devil that is in you. Get rid of it before getting rid of Mubarak. And alhamdulillah that they got rid of him. At least, inshallah, they saved a few billions. If they come back to the Muslims, inshallah. $1 billion, yani. No sorrow, yani, for people like Mubarak and Shayn al-Fajirin of Tunis and those people. There is no sorrow for them, yani. But things has to be done right, according to the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And those demonstrations are nothing but actions of the kafirs. They are not the right way. No.
Ninth principle. Do not apply the ahadith of fitan to the incidents and events you are living. Sheikh Saleh bin Abdulaziz Al Sheikh writes while explaining the ninth principle. It pleases people at the time of emergence of fitan, to look up ahadith of the Prophet concerning fitan, and this happens a lot in their gatherings. They say, Allah's Messenger said such and such, and this is its time, and this is the fitna, and similar statements. The Salaf, our predecessors, have taught us that the ahadith of fitan are not to be applied on the ongoing events.
This is very important, actually. You know what led to the fitna of Juhayman in 1980? Juhayman, a man who was living in between Saudi Arabia and Kuwait. No passport, nothing. He used to come cross the border without anything. He was studying in the Islamic University of Medina, according to some brother who was studying with him. He was telling us this story. He said, Juhayman studied until he was in the second year of Islamic University, and then all of a sudden he quit. He said, I quit. And we told him, why are you quitting? He said, because the Arabic language that we are taught here, it is taught by a teacher who has no beard. So I want to quit. This is un-Islamic. MashaAllah. And he wants to find an excuse not to seek knowledge, because those people don't stand knowledge. Because knowledge binds them, and they don't want to be bound. They want freedom in action, freedom in doing, you see. And knowledge binds you, you see. So they don't want something to bind them at all. And Then this person tells us, one day after quitting college, Juhayman came in the majlis of Sheikh Abu Bakr al-Jazairi, a great scholar in Medina. And he was sitting, but it appeared that something is wrong with him. He's angry. He's not liking the situation. He's not like usual. And then someone told him, Juhayman, what's wrong with you today? Why? He spoke angrily. And he said, the sheikhs don't speak the truth, and they don't forbid the evil, and this and this. And then he got up angrily and he left. Because his mind was filled by those takfiri thoughts from two Egyptians that visited Medina and chose to stay with Juhayman in his house and fill him with those garbage of takfir and that your scholars are this and that. Okay. So then what he did, he secluded himself now from the scholars. And what did the Prophet ﷺ say? If you separate yourselves from the scholars, even this much, that's like taking the ring of Islam from your neck. It's the way to kufr, you see? So that's what he did. And he started gathering with those takfiris and learning with them from the books directly and all that, And then finally, he reached the situation where he was interpreting the dreams that he see according to the hadiths of fitna. A lot of hadiths about fitna, that there will come a time a man with such and such description will do this and that. And so he was applying those hadiths to the current situation. Why? Because this suits him, his anger. He wants to get rid of those scholars and the government. Okay. So he wants to find a way to make it legal for him to go against them. So he said, from my analysis of those hadiths of fitna, I have come with surety that the year 1400 Hijri exactly is the year that the Mahdi will come out. Based on my understanding of those hadiths. This hadith that says this man and this man, that this man is meant, it's meant King Fahd or King this or King that. And this man is meant this, and this thing is meant that. And he explained everything according to what he likes. They went and asked Sheikh bin Baz about this. Sheikh bin Baz said, fear Allah, you don't decide this important issue of aqeedah, the coming out of the Mahdi, by dreams and by those things. You decide it by clear signs that the Prophet ﷺ has mentioned, that the Mahdi will fill the earth with justice. Has anybody filled the earth with justice now? No. Don't do this. And he left bin Baz. He went to Sheikh al-Albani. Sheikh al-Albani said, look, brother, look, my son, there are three types of dreams. One dream is from Allah, a knowledge from Allah, guidance from Allah. One dream is from shaitan. And one dream is from yourself, from your concern about something, and you will dream in something which goes along with what you are concerned about, you see. And he said, what you are dreaming is that third type, okay? Or it's from shaitan, be aware. He left Albani. He only wanted a fatwa from one of those two greatest scholars in their time, just to make his statement acceptable by the people, because they don't accept the stooges that are following him and thinking that he is a scholar. But the rest of the people will not accept, you see. So he went to say, oh, bin Baz said, agreed. And Albani said, but they did not agree, you see. Then when the other fitnas came afterwards, there was a guy called Arumi or something else in internet. He was saying, this is the time where the Mahdi is coming, or this is the time where this is coming. Based on their analysis of those hadiths, they apply the hadiths on those يعني, particular incidents that happen. This is not the right way. You cannot do this. You see? It's misleading. You see? And how about the clear hadiths where the Prophet ﷺ said, no fighting in Haram. And he said, Allah only allowed me and only 1 hour to fight in the Haram. The Prophet ﷺ said that. Okay? And then Juhayman neglected those hadiths and he took weapons to the Haram in the form of funerals. Janazah. Months before the incident, and they took their positions in the manaras and everywhere with their weapons and everything. Then, on the day of executing the plan, he gave a khutbah about the Mahdi, and he said, this brother Muhammad bin Abdullah is the Mahdi, and we had dreamed about it, and we have made sure, and all, and all this garbage. And Muhammad bin Abdullah is Qahtani, and the Mahdi is Muhammad ibn Abdullah, which belongs to the descendants of Fatima radiallahu anha. Okay. So he said he is the Mahdi, and we are sure about it, and therefore we want to give him bay'ah near the Kaaba now, just like the Prophet said, the Mahdi will be given bay'ah near the Kaaba and all this. Naam.
هذا من فضل ربي ليبلوني أأشكر أم أكفر ومن شكر فإنما يشكر لنفسه ومن كفر فإن ربي غني كريم.